The purpose of this video is to take you through the basic elements of music, assuming you know next to nothing about the keyboard. It's geared to anyone who can work independently and who's self-motivated. Over the years, I've developed a method of teaching music that doesn't rely primarily on reading notes, but stresses more theory and its direct application, and developing your ear and learning to play what you hear. It's like your native language. First you learn to speak it, and then later learn to read and write it. I feel that's the way to learn music. With a well-developed ear and an understanding of how music is put together, you can work from records and tapes, mimicking what you hear, and then incorporating what you choose into your own style. Let's start with this note. This one is known as A. The way we find A is look for three black notes, and it's the middle note, one a little higher in the middle. There's A. So this is A, and here's another three black notes. This is A also. This is A. So find all the A's on the piano. Now, knowing that this is A, this one is B, C, D, E, F, and G. And now we're back to A. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. The distance from this A and this A is an octave. From here to here is an octave. This is an octave. It's an eight-note interval. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Now, in learning the notes, you can't rely always on counting up from A to find that this note is an A, B, C, D, E. You have to know the name of that note based on its location to the black notes, not relative from another note that you know. So what I'm going to do is give you notes in random order and have you learn them just like you learned A. You look for three black notes and you found that being A. So where would E be? Here. Now when you find that E, find all the octaves of E on the keyboard. And each time you're finding them, you're not having to relate to A to find them. You're relating through the black notes. And this is the beginning of some ear training. Doing a scale might be about the simplest melody to figure out. And so let's try and do it by ear. And so let me show you the process. You start on D and play white notes until one doesn't sound right. You have a memory trace already of what that scale sounds like. And let's try it and see if we can figure it out. Do you hear something wrong there? If you do, you replace it with a note that's just adjacent to it. Because a major scale is just whole steps and half steps, so you're only a half step away from what you need to be. Let's try it from D again. So you always go back to the beginning, keep what sounds right, and then if something sounds wrong, replace it with a black note. So far, it's sounding good. Did you hear something wrong there? Let me do that again. Could you locate that other note that didn't sound right? It was this note. And so we'll replace that with the next note. C sharp. Let's listen to it now. How does that sound? So that's a D major scale. D has two sharps, the F sharp and the C sharp. What we're going to be dealing with here is improvisation. And now you're going to see the payoff from the work that you've done with your work in scales. When you want to figure out a melody, or you want to compose one, what you need to know is what key you're dealing with, or another way of saying what scale you're dealing with. And then, to compose a melody, you take those notes and rearrange them. So what I'm going to do is give you a number of suggestions on what you can do to make a scale sound a lot more interesting. So let's deal with the C scale. and maybe you can review it. One of the things we can do is hold notes for greater lengths of time. Let me give you an example. Okay, that's the first thing we can do. The second thing we can do is we can change direction, which would add a lot more interest. For instance, when we're dealing now with changing direction, we no longer have to consider keeping the same fingers on the same notes as we did when learning the scale. The next element I could suggest is that you take notes and skip them. You don't have to play in consecutive order. Let me give you an illustration. Much more interesting, much more melodic. That opened us up a great deal in what we can do. The next element would be taking a note and repeating it, which would give it a much more rhythmic quality. For instance, the last thing I can suggest is that whatever you play, try and play it again. Because most of the time when you hear a melody, there's repetition. And it has the quality of it being intentional. So off the top of my head, I'm playing something and then I'm going to play it again. Sometimes when you try to repeat what you've played, you can't, and that's okay also, because then what you end up doing is playing a variation on a melody, and that'll work out just fine. This one's going to be in 6/8 time, meaning that within that tempo, the units are broken up into groups of six instead of four. Let me play it for you. Rock and roll type feel. Okay, now what's happening here are the chords are going on all the eighth notes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is a tune that chords are being played constantly, and within a few minutes you're probably going to grow very tired. And the way to prolong that is do most of your motion from your wrist. If you try and do it from your arm, you're going to tire out very quickly. You're trying to be very relaxed over here and just work from your wrist. So we're going to be playing these chords for two measures each. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then go to the next chord. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there won't be any difficulty with that except for the constant playing of it. The left hand, again, takes the notes of that chord, the C, E, and G, and here's the pattern. Thank you. And to count it out, it'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Let's do that again. I'll do it slower. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's the pattern. Then you go through A minor. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Same pattern for each chord. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now the difficulty is always in putting your hands together. So let's do it slow and count it out. We'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Let's do that a few times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. One more time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then move on to the next chord, A minor. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Probably the thing that will give you some difficulty is getting to the next chord in time. So you must always be thinking about where you're going. It's like being in a car, you're not thinking about where you are, but you look off into the distance and think about where you're going. So you must always be thinking about your next chord. All right, let's try that in tempo, and then we'll speed it up. So we'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's hard to count and not take a breath. Okay, let's try it with the drum beat. We've already determined what key we're in by that first chord, E major. Now there are certain chords that should come up in the key of E major, and knowing that, we can limit our guesswork to predominantly those chords. Let's shift into C for a moment. The chords that should come up in C are these. We just lock our hand in place and play every other note of the scale. And they always come up in this order: major, minor, minor, major, major, minor, and diminish. And the diminish doesn't come up too often in a piece. So basically, when we're trying to figure out a tune in C, these were the choices we would go for. If we're in E, which is the case here, the chords that should come up are E major, F sharp minor, G sharp minor, A major, B major, C sharp minor, and G sharp diminished. Now think about this. If you're predominantly staying with those chords, and you've played one chord, and it's probably not the diminished chord, you only have six more possibilities, really. And out of the chords that we just covered, three are major, E, A, and B, and three are minor: F sharp minor, G sharp minor, and C sharp minor. And if your ear can hear whether it's major or minor, then you only have about two more choices. Now, it doesn't always hold that a tune just strictly stays within the melody notes or strictly stays within the chords. In this case, the tune will go out of the chord sequence about two times, but generally will stay within the chords in that key. So go and review the chords in the key of E before going on to figuring out the chords here. What I'd like to do is play the tune, and at every point there's a chord change. I'll point it out to you by just making a note like that. The way you hear the chord change is you listen to the bass player. The bass player is always playing the root note of the chord. Listen to the bass player. So now we're trying to totally ignore the melody. The melody is the loudest part. It's been mixed up the brightest on a tape. And what we have to do is listen behind the scenes as though the melody was the actor. And we want to take a look at what the set is. So let's look behind the scenes here. Here's a chord change.
What would you think if I sang out a tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me?
That repeats.
Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song, and I'll try not to sing out of key. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friend.
Chord.
I get high with a little help from my friend.
Chord.
Gonna try with a little help from my friend.
There are actually a chord there too. I'll show you that part later when we put the two hands together. And then the bridge. Okay, let's go and figure it out. Same process here, though we're listening to the bass player. Is he going up or down, and by how much? And with a bass player, it's even a more narrow guesswork here than in melody. Let's go into C for a moment again, just to show it more clearly. If a bass player is going to jump up, the most he would jump up most of the time is there. If he jumped up any more than that, if he wanted to go to A, it would be closer for him to go here than it would to go here. So if we can determine whether the tone is going up or down and it's going up, the most he'll probably go is this. So a large interval would be a fifth and maybe a fourth, and a small interval would be a second or a third. And so you only really have a guess of maybe two choices when you're looking for bass changes. Okay, we have the first one. And when we figure out chords, play the chord in the center of the piano, we ignore the melody, and we'll play the root note, what the bass player is playing down here. And there's usually a chordal instrument in the band, either a guitarist or a pianist, and we listen for the rest of the tones to figure out, is it major or minor? But if he's playing an E, we expect it a major. If he plays an F sharp, we expect it to be a minor. And then it might vary from that expectation. Here we go. Did it go up or down? Did it go up or down? It went up. So let's go up and let's first choose notes within the scale. It didn't sound like it went right up consecutively, so let's jump maybe to the A or the B. How'd that sound? Nope. Let's try B. How'd that sound? Sounded pretty good. Then what you do is you check it out with your chord over here. I expect it to be major because the fifth interval should be a major. Yeah, that sounded good. Okay, let's go to the third tone that we hear.
Here's a blues lick similar to the rhythm we just did. We had this. We could take the chord and just break it up. Instead of playing them solidly, and we can slide off the minor third to the major third. And all the possible combinations of that. Or we could even do go up to the seventh. Thank you. imagination just take hold of you as to what you can do. Just when you do something, maybe you can create a pattern by repeating it over and over again. You could keep that same idea. You have the B flat, and then you have the F7. Or even lead in. And then G, you have the same thing. Sliding off that note too for a blues note. There are two things to consider when improvising. What's your scale that's holding as a thread through the whole thing, which is your C pentatonic. But then you have the particular chord that you're working on. So when we're in F, besides these tones, we have this note. As though we were coming off the F pentatonic. So we now have the F tone. And when we're in G, we have use of this note that's normally in G. That normally wouldn't sound good if we were playing in C. It would be much too dissonant. So we have these notes when we're in C. We have these notes when we're in F. And we have these notes when we're in G, and most of them are the same. So here's one lick. Here's another one where we could work with sixth intervals. Or we could slide, come into the first one. Lock your hand in position. Just freeze it. And in G. And you can slide in from here. You can even trill any two notes. You could be using that. It's nice to have a melody where they're going in opposite directions. Another one for you. Besides what notes you can play.
Here's another one. It's a pattern. It's taking the first five notes of C, and we're going 1, 3, 5, 4, 3, 4, 2, 3. I'll do it again. C, E, G, F, E, F, D, E. Now what'll make this a lot more difficult is for you really to know your scales and then move up a half step. Taking the the first five notes in C sharp. Now move up to D. Now E flat. So do four of each. One, two, three, four. But do them slow. And so on. That's a real difficult one also for you to really know your keys and to go through all 12 keys that you have. Here's one that gives people some problems. Remember to do both these exercises in both your hands, okay? So this is going to be 1 and 3, 2 and 4, 3 and 5, 2 and 4. So I take, I do that a lot using as a little rhythmic idea in writing. So you're taking this idea, but doing it with some kind of rhythmic. Try and take it and do something with it. Manipulate it in some way, make it yours. The same idea with that other exercise, like, instead of, change the pattern. Maybe, juxtapose a different bass note to it each time. Take these exercises and be creative with them and see what you can do with them. What I often try to do is come up with a grouping of chords that cycle themselves, and that's a progression. We did some progressions in the first volume where I did the 1-6-2-5 and the 1-6-4-5 and showed you various rhythms that I could play those with that would totally change them around. So let me give you some more ideas about some progressions. This will be in the key of A. I'm just going to come up with four chords that I feel will cycle themselves nicely. So I chose A, F sharp minor, G sharp minor, and C sharp minor. And basically out of those four chords, I worked out a tune. I'll use this as a passing tone to come back to A. Now, I almost never play chords in root position all the time. I find that to be too common. And what I'll do to join chords together is keep some note that's usually sometimes a top note that will link them all together. So I'm going to go play the same chords with this G sharp on the top. I'll move it down to the F sharp there on that chord, on the G sharp minor chord. And then I'll cycle them again going to throw in the 9. I like the 9 a lot. And I came up with basically those same 4 chords with slightly different voicing that way. Now I'll try and put some rhythm to it to bring it together and keep that tempo going. So, that's the rhythm. Sort of like a bossa nova beat, I guess. Maybe that's where it came from. I've played bossa nova tunes before. Somehow it just got encoded in my hands, and I played those chords probably with a bossa nova beat. So then what'll pull it together even more is to throw in a bass line. Now what I can do is I can play bass lines and rhythm at the same time. I've sort of developed my style that way. But you don't need to be able to do it that way. You can just take those chords and put it down on tape. Then you can go back and work out your other part. Or you can work with a sequencer, which is what I'm using here. A sequencer is like a tape recorder, only it's a computer that will remember what the synthesizer has played and it'll play it back. So here's what it would sound like with drum beat. Think of it in groups of 16. With a bass line. Now that's set up for a groove for the tune, and some tunes might stay totally in a groove, but I always feel like I need another section. So then I put down another section. Very often I'll do that. I'll play something, and I'll do it again with a slightly different tag at the end. So it's a repetition, makes it familiar. That's a little different. And then what I can do sometimes, or what you can do, is to use the same chord pattern for your verse and your chorus and make it sound different by what you choose as a melody. So the next thing I did was I put that down into my sequencer, and then I can sit back and try to work out a melody. So that thing is just going. This is in the key of A, so I play around with the A scale. And then what I do is I'll come up with some melody after improvising, and this might take me hours. But I'll come up with a melody, and then I'll come up with an alternate melody, and usually my stronger melody I'll save for my chorus and play my first melody as my verse. Your chorus should always be stronger than your verse. So here's what I came up with. So it's repetition. And now chorus. So I'm in the key of A, so my primary chords are A, D, and E. Couldn't be any more basic than that. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's my verse. And then what I'll do for my bridge is go to the 4th chord, D, and then I'll go to the A chord with the C sharp in the bass. I'll do that 3 times. Then I'm going to go to B, and then E. And that's my bridge. And then I'm going to have a second bridge after that, which is a little more complex. But basically, that's my tune, chord-wise. So now what I'm going to do is put down a bass track. I've worked out all these parts ahead of time. I've put them down on a tape recorder, and I've listened to it, and I have a sense of what each part is going to be. It takes me sometimes quite a long time to figure out what each part will be. And then I might demo up a whole tune, and after I've listened to it, I might throw it away and do it all over again. It just requires sometimes doing things over and over again and just taking it all the way to completion. So I need to double the length of that part. And all I need to do to double the length of a part is to copy it to itself. So first my part was 8 beats long, and now it's going to be 16 beats long. And I'll call up my track that I'm going to play on, track 2 for my bass part, get my countdown and play it. And it's going to loop now. I like that. I should have mentioned also that with the drum track, I don't put any drum rolls in because it would be too redundant to hear it over and over again. And so I wait until I've demoed up the whole tune, and then as the last thing that I do is I'll put some fillers and drum rolls to make the drums seem more natural. The next thing I'll do usually after putting my bass part down is to put down my chordal part. And I'll try and keep it simple and spacious so I have room for my melody. Call up track 3. I'm going to double the length of that also. Now I'm 32 beats long. Enough space for my next part. There's a lot of space here. That sounds pretty good. All right, now I'm going to put my lead part on. Your basic 4 parts in a song is going to be your drums, your bass, your chordal part. Sometimes I have 2 chordal parts, 2 rhythmic parts. Sometimes I might have a sustained chord, and then I'll have some kind of rhythmic chord over that. And then I have my lead, or my vocal might be my lead. This is going to be an instrumental. I'm not going to have any vocal on it. I'll call up the sound that I'm going to be dealing with for the lead. And let's go. Thank you.